last event of GCC's 40th anniversary celebration, whose theme is Making Dreams Reality, and what a dream it is to launch this lecture series here at this college. And finally, and unfortunately tragically, it's the 75th anniversary of the executions of Nicola Sacco and Bartolomeo Vanzetti by the Commonwealth of Massachusetts in Boston in 1927. Some of you in the room know a lot about Henry Steele Commager, but for those of you who only know a little, or maybe know nothing at all, I'm going to try in a few words to capture the essence of the man. Henry was orphaned at the age of 8 and brought up in the household of his maternal grandfather. Throughout his schooling, he often had to work 40 hours a week to support himself, like many GCC students. So he understood the life of a community college student, and he also knew that community colleges are democracy's college. He was a man of seemingly inexhaustible energy and prodigious scholarship. He was funny, he was generous, he was brilliant, and as I learned in one of his classes, he could at times be intimidating. As the John Woodruff Simpson lecturer at Amherst College, he was an historian, a scholar, a teacher par excellence, a public intellectual who traveled like an itinerant preacher all around the country to educate citizens about democracy and what democracy is all about. And he may be remembered most for his courageous positions of dissent that he took during the height of McCarthyism, the Vietnam War, and the outrageous and illegal behavior of the Nixon administration. Easier to say what loyalty is not than what it is. It is not conformity. It is not preference for everything American over everything foreign. It is not the indulgence in ceremony, a flag salute, an oath of allegiance, a fervid verbal declaration. It is, though, a tradition, an ideal, and a principle. It is a willingness to subordinate every private advantage for the larger good. It is allegiance to the traditions that have guided our greatest statesmen and inspired our most eloquent poets. The tradition of freedom, equality, democracy, tolerance, the tradition of the higher law, of experimentation, cooperation, and pluralism. It is ultimately a realization that America was born of revolt, flourished on dissent, and became great through experimentation. I think the test of greatness is pretty simple. Does a person's words and actions stand the test of time? Are they pertinent today, 50 years later, and will they be pertinent 50 or more years from now? For me, the answer is a resounding yes, as the quote that I read, I think, proves. Henry Steele Commager was indeed a great man. Today, actually, we need hundreds and thousands of profiles in courage like Henry was, and there is hardly a one. And that one may have died in a plane crash in Minnesota less than 2 weeks ago. Let me conclude these remarks about Henry with the words of another former student of his, which I think captures the stature and importance of the person that we are honoring today, Henry Steele Commager. His death leaves a sense of vacancy, not only at Amherst College, but far beyond it as well. Many years will come and go before another such as he passes this way again. Now it is my pleasure to introduce Buzz Eisenberg, who's an attorney and faculty member in the criminal justice program at the college.
One other brief word about Henry Steele Commager. If tomorrow, actually I'm a professor so I can give you an assignment. Tomorrow I want you to find a meaty article about a controversial and important social issue. And I ask you to read that article tomorrow. And the next day, I ask you to find another one and read that. And I ask you to do that for 700 consecutive days. And by then, you'll have exhausted Henry Steele Commager's articles. That'll be about 2 years from now. Then I ask you to look for a book on similar issues and read one book a week for 40 weeks, and then read about 234 reviews that he wrote, by my reckoning, that comes to about April of 2006. That's how long it would take us to read his work at one article a day, one book a week. Can you imagine what it took to author it while he was lecturing, while he was a full-time professor, advising students, et cetera, et cetera? I echo what Alan said, an extraordinary man. Mary, thank you. Speaking of extraordinary men whose scholarship we have a lot to learn from, it's my privilege to introduce Dr. Sarat today. He, too, is quite prolific. He has authored more than 100 scholarly articles and either authored or edited more than 30 books, including The Killing State. It's ironic that I'm here to introduce him today. I was very honored when I was asked. Is Wesley Blixt here? Wesley Blixt was a reporter for the Union News for a decade or so, and he was covering the courts here in Franklin County, and he covered some of my exploits, including some of the death row work that I was doing, and he took that opportunity to take about a month off from his work, as I remember, and did an exhaustive survey of the death penalty in the United States at a time when Massachusetts was considering passing death penalty legislation. And in 1998, sometime after he had written that article, he gave me a gift I had never heard of, Killing State by Dr. Austin Sarat. It was personally inscribed to Buzz by Dr. Sarat, I guess at a book signing, and I read this book and was totally absorbed in this collection of essays by a number of great thinkers, two of whom I was fortunate enough to know, Hugo Adam Badeau and Bill Connolly. It's a powerful book. It's a powerful title, The Killing State, Capital Punishment in Law, Politics, and Culture. The Killing State. I hearken back to Hobbes, Locke, and Rousseau's The State of Nature, the state in that way, and also the state meaning the institutions of government, which we think of as a state. And I thought that had some meaning to me. Dr. Sarat is the William Nelson Cromwell Professor of Jurisprudence and Political Science at Amherst College. In 1997, he received the Calvin Award given by the Law and Society Association for distinguished research on law and society. He's currently the president, I think, of the Association of Law, Culture, and the Humanities. He's appeared in numerous newspapers and articles. If I had the time, I would tell you about those. He's appeared on the O'Reilly Factor, provided commentary on National Public Radio, MSNBC News, Fox News, among others. His teaching has been featured by the New York Times, The Globe, on NPR, on the Today Show. He is a distinguished scholar and a distinguished educator. He's also co-founded the Amherst College's newest academic department, which is Law, Jurisprudence, and Social Thought, and he's the chair of the Colloquium on the Constitution and the Imagining of America. We're very fortunate that he's here today. We're also fortunate that he's here today on this topic. This week, a new Scott Turow book was released that I'm looking forward to reading. It's called Reversible Error. I see Anne is nodding her head. Have you read it? Scott Turow, for those of you who don't know, before he became a successful lawyer, well, before he became a successful private lawyer and author, he was a prosecutor. And he described, as a prosecutor, the death penalty as an ugly necessity, but a necessity indeed. That's the language that he used. As many of you recall, recently 25 inmates on death row were surveyed by a criminology class. Whoever's here in my criminology class, that engaged in an innocent project and raised some funds and demonstrated that 13 of the 25 people on death row in Illinois were in fact innocent. And the proactive death penalty advocate governor of Illinois said, we better take a look at this, and called a moratorium on the death penalty and appointed a commission among whose number was Scott Turow to look into it. After looking into the death penalty and its implementation in the United States, Scott Turow announced that I have come to believe that constructing a fair and accurate system of capital punishment exceeds the grasp of human wisdom. and has said that he's reversed his position with respect to the death penalty. This week, we keep seeing articles coming from Maryland, Virginia, the United States Justice Department, and now Alabama and Louisiana, and perhaps the state of Washington, rushing to be the first to execute the suspects in the sniping case in the D.C. area. Last week, in In Re Kevin Nigel Stanford, the Supreme Court refused in an extraordinary measure by a 5-4 vote, despite the normal, what we call the rule of fours, that allows the Supreme Court to accept what we call certiorari, to review a case. They only review 100 out of the 10,000 that they're asked to review each year. If four justices say yes, they've always taken the case. In this case, four said they want to review whether or not a juvenile can be executed in the United States, compliant with the Eighth Amendment. You constitutional scholars will be interested in that. And even though four said, yes, we want to hear that case, extraordinarily and unprecedentedly, virtually, the other five said, no, we won't, contrary to their own rules. And the four wrote a scathing dissent to the denial of certiorari, the unwillingness to even hear the case, saying, this is a shameful practice incompatible with a civilized society. The death penalty is very much in the news today. Like Commager, Professor Sarat talks about something that is an important thing to each and every one of us because it speaks to how we want our society to treat those that have grieved us. It is my real privilege and honor to finally introduce you after two introductions, Dr. Austin.
Thank you all for coming out on what in the western part of Massachusetts counts as a gentle fall day. I'm really thrilled to be here and deeply honored to participate in this occasion. I had the good fortune of being a colleague of Henry Steele Commager, late in his career and early in mine. What distinguished Commager as a colleague was that he set an example of continuous engagement in the life of the mind. Indeed, I barely remember seeing Commager without a book. He's remembered quite fondly at Amherst commencements because for Commager, any time not spent thinking or reading seemed to be wasted time. So he would come to commencements and take his cap off and open a book and put it in his cap and read during commencement. Quite a remarkable thing to do, though for any of you who have been to a commencement, also a wise thing to do. I believe it was the occasion of his 40th or 50th year teaching at Amherst. Henry Steele Commager was deeply engaged in reading a book when the president of the college read a citation intended to honor him, and the colleague sitting next to him sort of nudged Henry to look up. Commager looked up to the swelling applause of the crowd and went back to reading his book. Commager wrote many great things, many important and enduring things. My personal favorite is a book he wrote in the early 40s called Majority Rule and Minority Rights. In that book, Commager warned American liberals not to put their hopes on the United States Supreme Court. He said, anyone with a historical sensibility understand that the United States Supreme Court will always be the friend of privilege and the defender of power. I want to try to take up a theme from Commager's book, Majority Rule and Minority Rights. I'd like to argue the following. The United States Supreme Court should not abolish the death penalty in the United States. Now, to make such an argument is, of course, to be engaging in a kind of act of a hypothetical about which we have nothing to worry. The United States Supreme Court is unlikely to abolish capital punishment in the lifetime of anyone in this room, especially after the elections of yesterday. But even if the United States Supreme Court could and would abolish the death penalty, I'd like to argue that it shouldn't abolish the death penalty. That the death penalty should be thought of in the United States as a profound issue of democratic responsibility. For Commager understood that the health of civil liberties, the well-being of civil liberties and civil rights in the United States, the health of those things was only as strong as the democracy. That the judiciary in the United States could not and would not save our liberties and our rights. In advancing that case, what I'd like to do is to argue that we are today in a particularly important period in our national consideration of capital punishment. Now, I need to make a confession. Unlike many others, I am not a death penalty academic. I've not devoted my entire career to the study of capital punishment. Indeed, only at two times in my career have I devoted serious scholarly attention to the issue of capital punishment. One was in 1972. In 1972, Justice Thurgood Marshall, then of the United States Supreme Court, filed a concurring opinion in a case called Furman versus Georgia. In Furman versus Georgia, the United States Supreme Court temporarily suspended the application of capital punishment, finding that under the statutes then in place throughout the United States, capital punishment was unconstitutional. At that time, more than 50% of the American public favored capital punishment. And Justice Marshall, who was an opponent of capital punishment, argued that capital punishment was incompatible with the evolving standards of decency of a humane society. Capital punishment was incompatible with the evolving standards of decency of a humane society. Now, he had a problem. More than 50% of the people of the United States endorsed capital punishment. Yet Marshall argued that capital punishment was incompatible with the evolving standards of decency of a humane society. How did he make that argument? He argued that if Americans knew the truth of capital punishment, they would reject it as incompatible with their values. He argued that Americans supported capital punishment in the abstract, but they didn't understand the truth or the reality of capital punishment. Well, this struck me in 1972 as an important research opportunity, an important opportunity to go out and find out whether Marshall was right. So together with a psychologist, colleague, and friend, we decided we would do a little study. We would go out and we would interview people about their attitudes towards capital punishment. We would then give them information about capital punishment, the best, the most scientifically respectable information, and then we would measure again to find out whether that information changed their views, consistent with what we call the Marshall hypothesis. Go out and talk to people, give them information, ask them again about their views, and see whether, in fact, when they were informed about capital punishment, they would change their views. We chose the most representative of American cities to conduct our work, namely Amherst, Massachusetts, went out into the community to do our study. We'd interview people, we'd give them information, and we'd post-measure, as the psychologists say. When informed about capital punishment, what we found is that people who supported capital punishment tended to move towards neutral. People who were opposed to capital punishment tended to become more opposed. Or as one of my colleagues said, proving only that residents of a college town like Amherst, Massachusetts will say anything to get rid of a social scientist on their front porch. I left the study of capital punishment after this work. Justice Marshall had the good judgment to cite this work in his opinion in Gregg versus Georgia. It was thrilled to be cited by a United States Supreme Court justice. I remember telling my aunt Irene, the matriarch of my family, about this. Irene, I've been cited by a justice of the United States Supreme Court in an opinion called Gregg versus Georgia. My aunt Irene, who's a rather religious woman, said, what difference does it make? It doesn't matter until it's in the Rhode Island Jewish Herald. I left the death penalty to engage in other kinds of work. I studied white-collar criminals. I studied the Law Enforcement Assistance Administration. I studied divorce lawyers. Wrote a book in the mid-90s called Divorce Lawyers and Their Clients. You can tell I have a gift for giving books titles. One of my colleagues, on hearing that I've titled this book Divorce Lawyers and Their Clients, suggested that the next title of my next book would be Homeowners and Their Mortgages. Alas, to your good fortune, I didn't take her advice. I returned to the study of capital punishment at the beginning of the 90s. I did so not as a death penalty academic, not out of the belief that my work would contribute to the abolition of capital punishment, not out of a belief that my work would make a difference in the policy domain. I returned to the study of capital punishment because I believe that capital punishment was a critical venue, a critical place to examine certain developments in American culture and society. What I was interested in was what I could learn about America by learning about the killing state. And what I'd like to try to do today in the remainder of my time is to talk a little bit about what I found. In doing so, I want to take you back to the work of Henry Steele Commager. How so? Traditionally, debates about capital punishment have been hung up, have been engaged with two kinds of issues. First, what I would call abstract philosophical argument. And second is what I would call narrow policy argument. Traditionally, arguments about capital punishment have revolved around philosophical questions on the one hand and narrow policy questions on the other. Now, I don't know any of you who are investors or if you invest your money, but if you're interested in investing in what I would call a slow growth stock that will be around for 100 years from now, but won't have much growth potential and not much risk, invest your money in the following proposition. The death penalty is revenge. That's a philosophical issue. Is the death penalty revenge? If it is revenge, many of its opponents say it ought to be abolished. If it is not revenge, many of its defenders say that it is retribution. So much of the argument about capital punishment traditionally in the United States has been, is it revenge? If so, it's unacceptable. Is it retribution? If so, it is acceptable. And I'll leave to you to parse the question of what is the difference between revenge and retribution. Or actually, I'll leave to you to parse the question of what is revenge and retribution. What is the difference between revenge and retribution? Yeah, no, you don't get to pass. Well, let's start again. What is revenge?
Getting back at somebody.
Right? The essential structure of revenge is a payback, getting back at someone. And retribution? You're a Greenfield student. What you don't know, just make up.
I guess I actually don't see much of a difference.
Terrific. What is alleged is that retribution is emotional and passionate. That retribution comes from an emotion and a passion, a desire to get back at someone. Retribution, the essential structure of retribution, is also the structure of a payback. But what is alleged about retribution is done without emotion, without passion. That retribution is governed by reason. That retribution is governed by norms of proportionality. So in the traditional debate about capital punishment, the issue was, is capital punishment vengeance, or is capital punishment retribution? That's what I'd call an abstract philosophical argument. And it's an abstract philosophical argument against which I would like to argue no progress has been made or can be made around the question about whether or not the United States ought to continue to use capital punishment. The argument about retribution and revenge, I am arguing, is a fruitless argument. If you want to put your money in a slow growth stock, put your money in that argument, because that argument will be around 100 years from now. And no one who is not now persuaded of the question of whether the death penalty is revenge or retribution will be persuaded by the pursuit of that argument. So I would like to bury that argument. I come to Greenfield to bury something. There's another kind of argument about the death penalty, which has occupied a lot of energy in the debate about capital punishment, and that is the question about whether or not the death penalty deters. This is what I call a narrow policy argument. Whether or not the death penalty deters. In fact, the way in which we'd have to frame that argument is we'd have to ask whether or not the death penalty is a more effective deterrent than would be an alternative punishment, let's say life imprisonment without parole. This argument has also raged for a long time about the death penalty. Does the death penalty deter? And social scientists have made a very good living doing study after study of the deterrent effect of capital punishment. The results of that work, I would like to suggest, are absolutely indeterminate. For every study that suggests the death penalty deters, there are countless studies that says the death penalty does not deter. And of course, there's the Ed Koch, Paul Cellucci position, which is, I'm scared of death, so everybody else would be scared of death as well. Why not think about the death penalty in regard to deterrence? Why not say that's what we ought to think about? I think you could imagine the following. Imagine that we had a death penalty in Massachusetts. Imagine that we had a death penalty in Massachusetts. What would it take for the death penalty to be an effective deterrent? What would it take for the death penalty to be an effective deterrent?
I don't know. I don't think it is a deterrent.
That's totally fabulous, but I'm not asking you your opinion. I'm asking you to think about whether or not we could make an argument about deterrence. What would have to be in place for the death penalty to deter you from, for example, taking out your justifiable anger against me? You follow my question?
Yeah.
What would have to be in place to stop you from doing something illegal to me?
I
Let me ask another question. Where's the most dangerous place for you to be? Where's the place where you are most likely to be subject to a crime of violence?
Anywhere alone.
Totally spectacular. That's fabulous. If you're alone, there will be no crime of violence. It's when someone else is present that you're in real trouble, right? The most dangerous place for you to be is in your home. You're much more likely to be assaulted or murdered by someone who loves you. You're much more likely to be assaulted or murdered by someone who loves you or someone who knows you than you are to be the subject of a predatory killing like the sniper killing. The next most dangerous place in the world to be is in a bar late at night drinking. Oh, I forgot, that's not the subject of today's lecture. Why in a bar late at night drinking? Because when inhibitions decline or passions rise, violence occurs. In order for the death penalty to deter, however, the potential criminal must be a rational calculator. Here's what you have to say to yourself for the death penalty to deter. And here's how it would go. I'm thinking of killing someone. By and large, I have good reason for killing that person. However, if I kill that person, what are the chances that I would be apprehended? That's the first thing. I have to calculate the chances I'd be apprehended. Second, what are the chances I'll be convicted? I have to calculate the chances I'd be convicted. Third, what is the chance I would be given a death sentence? And fourth, what is the chance that I'd actually be executed? Because as you know, there are almost 4,000 people on death row in the United States, and the United States, at the high point, about 3 years ago, executed 99 in 1 year. So we're stockpiling people on death row. We're not executing many people. So you'd have to do a quite sophisticated calculus to figure out whether or not you'd get the death penalty, whether or not you'd be executed. Most murders are crimes of passion or crimes of opportunity. Third most dangerous place for you to be? There you go. There you go. What was your career? The third most dangerous place for you to be is in a 7-Eleven or a convenience store working late at night alone. You're much more likely to be killed in an opportunistic crime, a robbery gone bad, than you ought to be stalked on the street and murdered. So I'd like to advance two propositions. The first proposition is the philosophical argument will lead us nowhere. The second argument is that the argument about deterrence will lead us nowhere. That ultimately the question of capital punishment is not a question of philosophy and it's not a question of policy. It's a question of American values. That the question of whether or not the United States retains capital punishment is a question of who it is that Americans wish to be. And what I'd like to try to do is to outline what I'm arguing is the new argument about capital punishment and to try to suggest why we are in this period of national reconsideration. First of all, let me give you some evidence that we are in a period of national reconsideration of capital punishment. Recent polls have shown that support for capital punishment has come down from its historic high of close to 80% to now in most polls in the low 60s. Support for capital punishment is still high, but is much less high than it was even a couple of years ago. Second, people who support capital punishment tend to support it less intensely than they did even several years ago. Third, when Americans are given realistic alternatives to capital punishment, for example, life without parole, support for capital punishment diminishes even further. Fourth, do any of you remember Michael Dukakis? You remember Dukakis? This is a reform service. You can speak back to me. Yes. Right? We remember Michael Dukakis. You remember the 1988 campaign that Dukakis ran. I'm going to refer to that at the end of my remarks today. But you remember that when Dukakis ran for president in 1988, George Bush, George I, George the Elder, ran against Dukakis by using the so-called Willie Horton ad. To be against the death penalty in 1988, to be against the death penalty about a decade and a half ago was to be a wild-eyed radical, or worst, some kind of mushy humanist. To be against the death penalty a decade ago or 15 years ago was to be continually confronted with the following question. Do you mean Ted Bundy doesn't deserve to die? Do you mean Gacy doesn't deserve to die? If you're old enough to remember, you often got the following hypothetical. You mean you wouldn't execute Hitler? To which my answer was no, he's dead. Why? Why were we confronted with those questions? Why were people who were opposed to capital punishment confronted with those questions? They were confronted with those questions because 10 years ago, 15 years ago, the debate about capital punishment was a debate about, quote, them, those who commit capital crimes. That debate has changed today. The debate is now about, quote, us, those in whose name the state kills, those in whose name the state kills. More evidence that we're in a period of national reconsideration of capital punishment. When the Pope several years ago came to Missouri and asked then Governor Carnahan to spare the life of an inmate on death row, the Pope helped to mobilize the American Catholic Church against capital punishment. So today, the hierarchy of the American Catholic Church is philosophically opposed and actively in opposition to capital punishment. Now, I don't know about the rest of you, but I don't think about the hierarchy of the Catholic Church as a group of wide-eyed radicals. Some more evidence that we're in a period of national reconsideration. Buzz mentioned that in January of 2000, Governor George Ryan of Illinois imposed a moratorium on the death penalty in Illinois. George Ryan is a staunch, rock-rib, Midwestern Republican who said the following, "I believe deeply in capital punishment. It just can't be administered well. I believe that capital punishment is philosophically justified and often deserved. We just can't administer it well." What's the evidence for that? Between 1972 and 2000 in the state of Illinois, 12 people were executed and 13 people were exonerated from death row. Their record was 12 right and 13 wrong, which at Amherst is an A minus. Here, I'm sure you give real grades. So Ryan said, "I believe in the simple but appealing proposition that by and large, it's better not to execute innocent people." How's that for a courageous statement? "I believe in the simple but appealing proposition that by and large, it's better not to execute innocent people. I can be in favor of capital punishment philosophically. I can believe that the death penalty is often justified. But the question of what we do about capital punishment is a question of who we are and who we want to be." More evidence for our period of national reconsideration of capital punishment. The American Bar Association, again, hardly a bastion of radicalism, has come out in favor of a moratorium. Paris Glendening, former governor of Maryland, has imposed a moratorium in Maryland. The state of New Hampshire, the legislature of the state of New Hampshire 2 years ago voted to abolish capital punishment. Governor Jean Shaheen, to her eternal discredit, vetoed the abolition bill. Would it have made a huge difference? It wouldn't have made a huge difference. There was no one on New Hampshire's death row, and New Hampshire hadn't executed anyone for 100 years. Again, another indication of the courage of our politicians. They voted to abolish the death penalty, but Shaheen didn't want to be associated with a soft-on-crime Democrat, so she vetoed it. More evidence for a period of national reconsideration. By the way, if you're getting tired of this, just raise your hand and I can stop. More evidence for a period of national reconsideration. Conservative columnist George Will and the Reverend Pat Robertson have expressed their opposition and their concern about capital punishment. And everybody in the abolitionist community does exactly what you just did, which is to say, with allies like that, I am reconsidering my position on capital punishment. Now, why do I say these are indications that we're in a period of national reconsideration of capital punishment? Here's the claim I want to make. The new abolitionism, about which I'm going to speak, the new abolitionism is a form of political and legal conservatism. The new abolitionism, about which I'm going to speak, the new abolitionism which connects the debate about capital punishment to Henry Steele Commager's deep commitment to the health of democracy, and his understanding that democratically understood civil liberties were essential to the health of democracy, the new abolitionism has made capital punishment into an issue of civil liberties and civil rights. So no longer do we have to answer the question, if you're against capital punishment, do you think that Ted Bundy should not be executed, or Gacy shouldn't be executed, or Osama bin Laden shouldn't be executed? My answer to all those questions is each of them deserves execution, but that tells us nothing about what we should do. Each of them may deserve to be executed. In fact, to execute Osama bin Laden or Ted Bundy or Timothy McVeigh or Gacy is to give them a punishment which is too light, too little. But that doesn't tell me anything about whether we should execute anyone. So what is the new abolition? Where does it come from? How does it connect to Commager's concern about democracy, civil rights and civil liberties, and why does it lead me to say that even if the Supreme Court would abolish capital punishment, which is not going to do in anybody's lifetime, it shouldn't, even if it could. And that people who are opposed to capital punishment ought to carry on their opposition to capital punishment in a way that is respectful of democracy, that doesn't seek its suspension through a Supreme Court decision. Here's what the new abolitionism is. It says, as I've said, that philosophical arguments about capital punishment tell us nothing about what we ought to do. That policy arguments about capital punishment tell us nothing about what we ought to do. We know certain things about capital punishment. We know, for example, that the state of Wisconsin does not have capital punishment, and that the state of Illinois does have capital punishment. We know that murder rates are not higher in Wisconsin, they are higher in Illinois. We know that the state of Michigan does not have capital punishment, and its neighboring state, I hope I'm doing well here on the geography test, Ohio, does have capital punishment, and that murder rates are no higher in Michigan. The argument about deterrence could go on forever. The argument about revenge and retribution could go on forever. The new abolitionism says put it aside. Here's what we ought to be talking about. Increasingly, here's what Americans are talking about. Can we maintain capital punishment? Can we maintain a killing state and still be the people who we want to be? Because the argument about the death penalty is not about McVeigh, it's not about Osama bin Laden, it's not about Ted Bundy, it's not about Gacy, it's about you and me. It's about who we want to be and what kind of society we want to live in. And it's an argument that begins from the love of law. If you love the law, you have to be against capital punishment. It's not about Gacy, it's not about Bundy, it's not about Osama bin Laden, it's not about Timothy McVeigh, it's about our Constitution, our laws, and our values. So here's some things to think about as you think about the new abolitionism. The new abolitionism says the following: until it can be shown that there is no risk of error in the system of capital punishment, we should not execute anyone. Until it can be shown that there is no risk of error in the system of capital punishment, we should not execute anyone. Why shouldn't we execute anyone if there is a risk of error? Because the idea of due process is attached to a very simple idea, and that is, don't punish the innocent. And this is Ryan's point. This is Governor Ryan's point. There is no such thing as a perfect system of capital punishment. So long as there's a possibility of error, there's an offense, a grave and deep offense, to the value of due process of law. So if you love due process of law, you have to be opposed to capital punishment. Not philosophically. You want to be philosophically attached to capital punishment? Be philosophically attached to capital punishment. Ask yourself the following question: should the United States retain capital punishment if it runs a substantial risk of executing innocent people? And remember the statistics out of Illinois, and Illinois is not anomalous. 12 got 12 right and 13 wrong. Second part of the new abolitionism also appeals to the value of due process of law. When George Bush Jr., ran for president of the United States, he ran out of the state of Texas. The state of Texas at that time was America's execution capital. By the way, I have some very important advice for you. If you're going to murder someone, do not do it in Texas. Do not do it in Oklahoma. Do not do it in Missouri. Do not do it in Virginia. Feel free to kill someone in Connecticut. They have a death penalty. They don't use it. Feel free to do it in New Hampshire. They have a death penalty. They don't use it. Don't do it in Massachusetts. It'll stir up the politicians. We'll have to go through the whole Megillah again. Why do I tell you that? Because another fact of the new abolitionism is to point out the arbitrariness of the system of capital punishment. Whether you get the death penalty depends not on the gruesomeness of your crime, but where you do it. Whether you get the death penalty in the United States depends not on the gruesomeness of your crime, but whether or not the judges in that state are elected or appointed. No one's fate should depend upon the arbitrary factor of geography. That's what the new abolitionism argues. When George Bush ran for president out of the state of Texas in the spring of 2000, he was confronted with the sleeping lawyer phenomenon. Buzz wanted to give you an assignment. Well, here's no assignment at all, just a question. Is it or should it be constitutional in the United States for someone to be executed whose lawyer slept through part of their trial? Are you having a class tingle? Sleeping in class is not a capital crime. It's deeply offensive to everything I believe in, however. But in the United States today, it is constitutional to execute people whose lawyers slept through part of their trial. So long as they didn't sleep through the meaty part. Reminds me when I was 12 years old and I looked at Ladies Chatterley, don't record this. And I looked at Lady Chatterley's Lover for the meaty parts. Well, the United States Supreme Court has basically said that lawyers can sleep. It's okay for them to sleep so long as they don't sleep through the meaty parts of the trial. So, the second tenet of the new abolitionism is we shouldn't execute people whose lawyers sleep. We shouldn't execute people on the basis of the geography of where they committed their crime. Third tenet of the new abolitionism, we shouldn't execute people because of the race of their victim. We shouldn't execute people because of the race of their victim. In the late 1980s, the United States Supreme Court, in a case called McCleskey versus Kemp, the most shameful decision of the 20th century made by the Supreme Court, other than the Korematsu decision, and I have some other candidates for shame, said that racial discrimination in the death penalty is not a reason for invalidating the death penalty unless it can be shown to affect an individual and his case. They were confronted with the following evidence. You are more likely to be executed, everything else to the contrary, notwithstanding, because of the race of your victim, not your race. You're 4 times more likely to be executed in the United States if you murder a white person, regardless of your race. This isn't a race of the offender argument. It's a race of the victim argument. And the argument was, what this shows is that Americans value white life more than the life of persons of color. So ask yourself the following question. Do you believe in equal treatment under the law? Do you believe in equal? See, I'm not talking about the death penalty. I'm talking about civil rights and civil liberties. I'm talking about something that all Americans can believe in, regardless of their views about Bundy, regardless of their views about bin Laden. We shouldn't execute people because of the race of their victim. And then, of course, last but not least, the magic bullet in all of this, DNA. Now, if you are a liberal, DNA is, well, let's put it this way, not an unmixed blessing. The idea that we'd all be subject to DNA testing or DNA fingerprinting should remind you, if you're old enough to remember the name George Orwell, of someone named George Orwell. But DNA has played an important role in showing something to Americans, and that is that the system of capital punishment in the United States is error-prone. Without DNA, it's mere speculation. Hugo Badeau and Michael Ratlin wrote a book several years ago on the problem of innocence, and they speculated, they thought they could identify cases in which actually innocent people had been executed, but it was mere speculation. DNA fingerprinting, to the extent that you believe it and believe it is reliable, has now demonstrated to us how error-prone the system of capital punishment is. Why is it so error-prone? It's error-prone because it is the most politicized part of the criminal justice system. It's error-prone because when there is a gruesome crime, as there ought to be, there is community outrage. When there is a gruesome crime, there is a desire for vengeance. And that is natural, and that is explicable, and that is what ought to happen. How that desire for vengeance, how that outrage is channeled, is our responsibility. The responsibility of every citizen of the United States, because when the state kills in the United States, it kills in our name. Any of you taking constitutional law? You're taking constitutional law? You can't, it's not guilt by association, it's now your problem. What are the first 3 words of the American Constitution?
We the people.
Totally fabulous. Totally fabulous. Now I gotta have a slightly different question, a harder question. It's okay. What's the difference between the Constitution and the Ten Commandments? Oh, this is really good. You can call me Rabbi Sarat.
One binds the citizens of the United States and the other you can choose to believe in based on your religion.
Totally good, right? One way in which you could argue that the Constitution differs from the Ten Commandments is the Constitution's about us, right? It's about us. It binds us. Totally good, right? Capital punishment is a critical indication of who we want to be. Who we want to be. We the people. The Constitution's about us. And the issue of capital punishment is an issue of who we want to be. And what I'm trying to argue with you is that whatever your philosophical views are about capital punishment, you may think it's great. You may believe that it is justified. But at the end of the day, capital punishment is not a philosophical question. At the end of the day, capital punishment is a very practical question. It's about how the state acts in our name. The new abolitionism holds out the possibility that liberals and conservatives can come together to defend American values. It opens up the possibility that people like George Ryan can say, I'm philosophically in favor of capital punishment. I just don't believe that we can administer it in a way that respects what I believe in. Now, I promise you a return to Michael Dukakis, and I'd like to end my talk with a return to Michael Dukakis and then hopefully entertain some of your questions. Here's my return to Michael Dukakis. I want to take you back to the year 1988. I want to remind you of the second presidential debate, 1988. The first question in the second presidential debate in 1988. Do all of you remember that? Any of you remember that? Where do you people live? Do you live in big cities? If you live in small towns, you're going to take your entertainment wherever you can get it. I memorize presidential debates. In the second presidential debate, Bernard Shaw started the debate by asking Michael Dukakis the following question. Bernard Shaw, who was then the lead anchor of CNN, asked Michael Dukakis, Governor Dukakis, I know you're opposed to capital punishment. If your wife, Kitty, were raped and murdered, what would your view be? How's that for a question? You thought my question about the first three words of the Constitution was hard. Well, you'll remember what Dukakis said. He said, oh, Bernie, that was a mistake. You should have called him Mr. Shaw. Oh, Bernie, you know I'm against capital punishment. And then they changed the subject and delivered a 20-minute lecture on drug education. And everybody in Massachusetts sighed and thought, water in his veins, not blood. I'd like to conclude by conjuring a different response to that question, a response that captures the new abolitionism. Here's the response that Michael Dukakis would have given had he been Mario Cuomo. Well, I promised you Dukakis, but I'm going to give you Cuomo. Here's my fantasy of Mario Cuomo's answer in 1988. It would have gone something like this. Well, Mr. Shaw, of course I wouldn't want anyone who did such a thing to someone I loved to be made to suffer. Indeed, if I got my hands on him, I'd tear him limb from limb. Are you having a Cuomo tingle? But the death penalty is something different. What my love and anger, you see, Mr. Shore, propels me to do is not what our government should do. Our government should help heal my pain, but also find ways to punish that do more than exact the most primitive kind of bloodlust and vengeance. The government should help heal our pain, but not offer the promise of a simple response to complex problems, the problems of violence that plague our society. The government should help heal my pain, but reject a punishment that risks executing the innocent or is imposed in a racially discriminatory way. You see, Mr. Shore, I love my wife, Kitty. That would have come as a real surprise to Cuomo's wife, Matilda. You see, Mr. Shaw, I love my wife, Matilda. And then Cuomo would have paused, and he would have choked up a little bit, and he would have said, but I love America more. Anyone who murdered my wife might deserve to die in some abstract philosophical sense. And by the way, Cuomo would have kept talking because he loved the sound of his own voice. But Cuomo would have said the death penalty is no mere philosophical abstraction. While it would not bring my wife back to life, it would demean and damage those things that I love about America, our commitment to justice, our commitment to equality, our commitment to fairness, and our commitment to the simple but appealing proposition that we should never execute the innocent. Those are the things that make me proud to be an American. Those are the things that my wife, Matilda, would want me to stand for. If Michael Dukakis had given that answer, he might have become president of the United States, and that is a thought too dreadful to contemplate. But it is an answer, I think, that captures the spirit of the new abolitionism in the United States, a spirit which provides a venue to talk about capital punishment that connects it to civil liberties, civil rights, and our commitment to democracy. Thank you very much, and I hope we can have some conversation and questions.